So we are almost halfway, because Pakistan was created in 1947, and when we are talking about the conclusion of 21st century, so that means we are halfway. So it has to be seen what have we done so far and what is to be done left over of this period. National interests get the top priority because all elements of national power are supposed to be employed towards achieving the national interests. Secondly, if somebody tries to sell you that the national interests of any country are driven by moral values, take it as a crap. It is not possible. So there is no morality in achievement of national interests. And if you dispute that, I will qualify my point. And thirdly, there are no permanent friends and foes. You can see strange bedfellows. And the recent example has been of Saudi Arabia and Israel. They seem to be strategic partners. So please be mindful of these ground realities when we are talking about national interest. I was at loss when I was configuring my presentation, structuring it, that how to put across what are the national interests. So I have categorized into three. Generally they are categorized as economic national interests related to economy. And after Dr. Ishrat Hussain speaking on this, I am in no position to comment, because that was an excellent resume of what has to be done in economic field. Then are ideological interests of any country. And then is the security interests. So what I have done is that, another point to remember is that all these interests are interdependent. There would be a policy which would take care of the security interests but might run at tangent with the economic interests of the country. Or there could be policies which are taking care of the economic interests, but concurrently they augment the security interests of a country. So what I've done is that I've grouped them together into the vital national interests of Pakistan, which in my reckoning what are important for us to traverse the leftover period of the 21st century. What are the national interests? They cause the existential, if they are not met, they are not taken care of, they endanger the very security and existence of a country. So those are the vital national interests. And what are those? First I have listed is national harmony. Then is economic well-being of masses, of the people. Defense and security. Then is national and religious values. And then we have positive regional and global environment. Now, you can dispute that such interests should have been at higher priority or lower, and you can add number of other interests, but in my reckoning that these five vital national interests sum up the complete game. Now, let me talk about the national harmony. The national harmony is imperative to making Pakistan strong, stable, and prosperous. Religious dissonance is highly detrimental towards achieving national harmony and unity. And when I deliberate upon it further, I tell you that we have religious sensitivities. We are, even those people who are not practicing Muslims, in deep recesses of the heart, they are very sensitive to the religious issues. So these have been playing a part in our internal dissensions, in creating polarization in society. So therefore, we have to take care of this. Unity amongst the people. And it runs vertical and lateral. Haves and have-nots. And then laterally, people from Balochistan and people from Punjab, people from KPK, people from Fatah, people from Gilgit Bastistan, Azad Kashmir. So there has to be harmony. If there would be people-to-people harmony, the other things would fall at their place. Unity and harmony amongst the federating units, and please forgive me, in Kashmir, please, I have missed it, we couldn't find a slide, my boys couldn't find a slide, to include Gilgit and Baltistan. Now, Pakistan is composed of federating units. Now, how to achieve harmony between the federating units? And we have economic parity. Yes, the world over, if you see USA, they are prosperous states, and there are states which are not prosperous. But the imbalance is not such that in Pakistan, certain people are living in Stone Age, and then we have prosperous Lahore and Islamabad, and perhaps Faisalabad, Karachi and all. So there has to be economic parity between the federating units. Opportunities in development. I am blamed of being saying things too starkly. If I ask you a question that which was the country which needed most the mass transit system in Pakistan? Karachi? Have you seen the public transport in Karachi? It is pathetic. And where does the money funded through CPAC goes? Goes to Punjab. I am a very proud Punjabi, Lahore from Lahore. And you see those metro services and those orange train and so many other things coming up. This creates disparity. One is reminded of the Sheikh Mujib days when they used to see the development in Islamabad and say that they smell of the bounties being coming from East Pakistan. Erstwhile East Pakistan. So therefore, if you have to take care of the national interests, this is very vital. Then stakeholders in national policies. Every federating units must feel part of and parcel of the system, that they are stakeholders in the policies. They are consulted. And recently I saw a clip that chief minister of one of the bigger province has gone with the prime minister to OIC summit. Where were the chief ministers? They are lesser important. So I think that we have to wake up to the reality, and the concept of big brother has to be understood differently. Everybody should be a stakeholder. You will make Pakistan stronger, more harmonious, and prosperous. Then is the governance. I think Dr. Ishan Saab very elaborately said that everything is related to governance. If equal governance or better governance is provided to all the people from one stretch of the country to the other, then you will make Pakistan this Pakistan will become stronger in terms of the strength of the people. Then is the national level politics. To me, those political parties which are doing politics at the national level are an asset to this country. And I think any process or any will by anybody to dismember a party or wish that this national party should wither away is a wrong approach. Political parties, because they have to carry forward the political system. So we should encourage the national level politics, and those sectarian politics or localized politics, like someone saying that Fatah is not part of Pakistan, that is something antiquated and absurd. There is nothing as Durand Line. It is only part of one border which exists. Therefore, we must encourage the political parties which do politics at the national level, and then try to encourage them, and whereas discourage the localized parties or the sectarian politics. then unity and harmony amongst the state institutions. We have seen a lot about this disharmony between the state institutions. People say that there is an establishment. Well, establishment is in every country. You think the US president is wise enough to articulate all these policies which is unfolding? Is he that intelligent? And I can quote a lot of things about many other heads of the states and people who matter. Establishment is everywhere. So don't try to demonize the establishment. It is a state institution working for the betterment of the country. So constitutional roles are determined. Constitutional roles are determined. It is a democratic system, parliamentary system, but then parliamentary system has to be functional. As Mr. Baba was mentioning, that everything should be routed through a system to the foreign ministry. There is a head of the one state, drives into the mansion of the former prime minister, and nobody knows about it. And he's a private guest. And there is no government functionary present there. The two families, good enough. Then somebody had to be briefed, either the president of Pakistan or the National Security Council, that what was the discussion going on, or the defense committee of the cabinet, somebody. Only then the parliamentary system works. It is not a monarchy. We have constitutional roles are determined of everybody, of the establishment, of the judiciary, of the legislature, and everybody. And in 21st century, if those bounds are met and those limits are understood, I think we will be able to take care of our national interests better than before. Then institution building. We must build the institutions rather than having discretionary powers. The system must work. We must build the institutions. And when I'm talking about the institution, every institution. And this comes through merit-driven system and leadership. Put the right leaders, you require about 200 people to put as head of the institutions, the most professional ones, and they will deliver. And the professional ones will like to have number 2, 3, 4 and subordinates as the professional people. All institutions work towards national interest. They must work. National interest has to supersede the personal interest. Our tragedy is that in our decisions, which are of national level, we tend to take care of the personal interests and not the national interests. Then there has to be a system of conflict resolution. If there is a dispute between one institution and another, have a bill passed. Have a conflict resolution system, but criticizing an institution in a very imbalanced manner, passing all the extremes, it makes the country weaker. It makes the system of governance weak. It makes the system of running the country weak. So therefore, there has to be. And the last point here, commonly talk about the bureaucracy. And please, sir, with your permission, I would like to quote an incident. I have put it here earlier also. We like to benchmark ourselves with India and Bangladesh and all. So I was DG Rangers Punjab many years back. So I happened to travel to India, and I was in Chandigarh. We were invited for a dinner by my counterpart, who was a police officer. So it is a capital of three states, Union Territory, Haryana, and Punjab. So when we got into discussion over dinner, so one of the chief secretaries of the province, I said, "General, you are mistaken. You are mistaken. India is ruled by the politicians, but it is governed by the bureaucracy. Because bureaucracy is the terminal end, is the tool which delivers the governments. If your bureaucracy is politicized, if it is partisan, if it is dysfunctional, and number of competent people just are on the sidelines being OSDs, who will deliver? So bureaucracy is the tool which has to deliver the governance. And we have got to rehabilitate the image. What happens? Who's the custodian of the district? The DCO? District Coordination Officer? If he's posted, from the day one he starts, he feels so insecure that his policies are directed towards securing his job. So is the police. So therefore, the bureaucracy has to live up to the expectations of the people. They must be the most honorable and competent people. Let's have a system if we have to take care of our national interests. Economic well-being of the masses, sir. After today's number of presentation, I have nothing much to say. I just will show you the slides. Wanted to cover the agriculture. Since I have been guarding the border, as a DG Rangers, you see across all green, highest per acre yield in the world, and this side, no. We have to take, we are an agrarian economy. If you focus on agriculture, the migration to the urban centers will stop. And what happens? I'm sorry, I'm talking about the recent examples, and I'm not criticizing the government at all. I talk on merit. I'm talking on merit. You see, recently, there was a lathi charge on, I hope the foreigners understand lathi charge. There were riots by the cane producers, sugar cane producers. They were not being given their dues.
Baton charge.
Baton charge, sorry, baton charge. So there's an ex-police officer who knows. So, baton charge. So, we must focus on our farmer. And this hub, food security, everything will come up through taking care of the farmer. Our agriculture appliances are antiquated. Our agriculture system is antiquated. We should focus on that. That will bring prosperity and not focusing on brick and mortar. Energy security and affordable energy. Clear energy, clean energy. One point, sir. I beg to differ, sir. That is that we have to focus on alternative energy and clean energy. I went to, if you visit Korea, you will find that they only grow rice and seaweeds and a few vegetables. There's nothing. But they have the largest shipbuilding industry in the world, where they make the about 100 specialized tankers in a year. And I said, from where do you get power? All is coal power. But they have latest technologies also. So we need, at least for 20, 30 years, we need a hybrid system. We need hydroelectricity. We need coal electricity also, because that is cheap coal available. But it has to be affordable, and the deals have to be transparent. Business and commerce, already talked. We have to give job opportunities to the people. This is in our national interest. And when we go into the 21st century, this is a very important point I want you to register, that the latest technologies which are coming, those are not labor intensive. But if you resort to those technologies which are not labor intensive, you will be denying job opportunities to our people. We should have an industry which gives job opportunities to the people. Nobody talks about it in Pakistan. In USA, another modern world, in Europe, the people contest elections that we are going to give such job opportunities to the people. So therefore, if you don't give job opportunities, that day I was talking in Karachi about same kind of subject. So we had the governor also, honorable governor there, and he said jobs are available. There was a scholar on the television. The other day he was saying that look how lucky we are. That there was a time, about 40 years, 50 years back, that only blind and physically impaired people used to come to madrasa for admission. And now there are a queue of people He is right, but the reason is because there is no alternative for them. There is a person with 6 children, he can't afford to provide livelihood to the people, to the children. So what he does is that he shoves them into a madrasa. And we don't have very many mosques to accommodate them. So therefore a right strategy to bring them into mainstream. Religious sensitivities I am talking about. There has to be a culture of acceptance and tolerance. Nobody is going anywhere. We all are Pakistanis. And we have got our national interests in 20th century. We'll be well served if we are united as a one country. Image of Pakistan, sports and culture. I come to an end, and because the chairman was seeing his watch, but I am not entirely to be blamed. In conclusion, I'll just list down the vital national interests to recapitulate 5 of them, and you can bundle up not many policies and interests into this. And this is my parting comment. National interests represent the aspirations of the people. They have to essentially keep them in the focus for ensuring their security and well-being. Any effort that divorces people or a segment of people from the process of national building is bound to be counterproductive and an exercise in futility. People's-oriented policies they always survive and make country prosperous. Pakistan is a great country. We have a great potential, and inshallah ta'ala, we will bounce back. Problems are there, and we will see that Pakistan will again emerge as a dominant player in the regional and global affairs and ensuring prosperity of the people of Pakistan. Thank you, sir.